kidnappings in the border area have really reached what I would consider epidemic proportions.
I was laying on the floor. I just couldn't move. The chains that I had, any noise that they would make, it was for sure they were going to beat me up.
Now, who is doing these kidnappings? Who's responsible?
We believe it's different groups, factions of cartels that either currently exist, drug cartels, or that previously existed. We have had several instances where Americans have been kidnapped in this country and then brought south of the border, held there while the whole ransom process takes place. And that aspect of Americans being kidnapped on American soil is particularly disturbing.
Coming up, weapons of warfare, how guns from the U.S. are helping to fuel narco violence across the border.
The drug cartels in Juarez have advertised openly they will pay $5,000 for an AR-15, AK-47 type rifle, no questions asked.
Every day along the U.S.-Mexico border, scenes like this are happening. A car is pulled over and searched.
Show me, buddy. Show me. Oh,
drugs are recovered. These agents are battling to keep illegal drugs produced in Mexico or transported across Mexico from entering the U.S. To help block smuggling, the U.S. has been building a border fence since the 1990s.
It's Mexico. Right through that hole.
So we'll continue on west, and then we'll run into Smuggler's Gulch.
We met Agent Alatorre, who took us on a tour of the border fence in the San Diego sector.
The patches of concrete that you see in the road that we're currently on were all tunnels that were discovered by Border Patrol agents.
So there's so many of them right here, like 1, 2, 3, yeah. 4, 5,
yeah, and we
six.
Just passed two.
So these are like 6, 7, 8 attempted tunnels?
Exactly. And they figure that it's easy enough, so, you know, there's quite a few attempts in this area.
As we drove, we saw new construction designed to foil smugglers.
Over here, you can see across into Mexico and the pretty flimsy existing border fence, which is why they're building this new one right here.
So Agent Alatorre was just saying that in this neighborhood over here, you can see it's pretty run down. The smugglers will pay people here, say $50, give them a cell phone, and have them be lookouts over here so they can call and they can give them intelligence and say, you know, the agents are patrolling or now it looks like it's a clear time to cross. As we drove on, we saw that even Smuggler's Gulch, a rocky canyon that's been inaccessible to Border Patrol vehicles, is undergoing a massive transformation.
So they have basically just knocked out this mountain here.
Yeah. What they did is they scraped off the sides of the canyon and started to push all of the dirt that they're scraping off into the canyon itself. Again, the end result is gonna be 1.3 million cubic yards of dirt that they're gonna push into this canyon. It makes it easier to install the secondary fence, install the camera systems, and install the lighting, all to try and maintain operational control of our nation's border.
While the U.S. is trying to combat the smuggling of drugs into the country, the Mexican government is trying to keep a different kind of contraband purchased in the U.S. from being smuggled into Mexico.
You can see the no gun signs.
In Mexico, private citizens are largely barred from possessing guns. Yet, just like illegal drugs in the U.S., there are plenty of guns available to Mexico's warring cartels.
Organized crime goes into the United States and buys arms that they come here and they use against police officers and they use against army and they use against each other.
The U.S. federal agency in charge of fighting gun smuggling to Mexico is the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms.
These drug cartels have the money and they can afford these weapons. At least 90% of the weapons recovered in Mexico originate in the United States.
How do you know that? Is that because you've traced them back to the
exactly.
U.S.?
Exactly. That's based on the trace information.
So when you're talking about guns from the U.S. going into Mexico, what states are we talking about?
Mainly it's the four bordering states, Texas is the main one because Texas is so big, it's the most of their legal guns or guns being illegally trafficked come from Texas.
Texas is one of the few states that permits the sale of assault weapons.
What you see are all legal firearms in the trade.
In Texas, it's legal for U.S. citizens to buy an assault weapon after undergoing a background check. But purchasing weapons for someone else, or say a drug cartel, is called a straw purchase and can get you a minimum of 5 years in federal prison.
What are the three things you look out for in a suspicious purchase?
An individual coming in and asking for a firearm that they have no concept what it is. An individual coming in requesting multiple purchase of the same type of firearm. The third is an individual who is obviously, because of their nervousness or lack of understanding, is uncomfortable coming in and making a purchase, and then we question that. And these are usually females who have been offered money to make this purchase.
Guns for sale in Texas can be worth much more in Mexico, even if smuggling them there is a violation of Mexican and U.S. law.
The drug cartels in Juarez have advertised openly they will pay $5,000 for any AR-15, AK-47 type rifle, you know, no questions asked. If somebody will pay you $5,000 for one of these guns up here, what kind of a chance would you take to buy one? Or steal one and try to get it south.
Coming up, we head to the birthplace of narco trafficking in Mexico.
So you have the most powerful drug cartels in Mexico, and their families all come from this region, and some of the family members are buried here at the cemetery.
She's telling me that it's not a good idea to stay too long here because people are watching us right now. Okay.
Although Mexico's drug war is largely being fought out in cities like Tijuana and Juarez, because those are the smuggling corridors into the U.S., you could say it started far from the U.S.-Mexico border in the small Mexican state of Sinaloa.
This area is home to the notorious Sinaloa cartel, which is run by Joaquin Guzman, also known as El Chapo or Shorty. And El Chapo used to run the cartel with his trusted associates, the Beltran Leyva brothers. And even though this area is a notorious drug trafficking region, for a very long time, things were pretty peaceful. The narcos didn't bother the locals. Locals didn't bother the narcos. And a lot of people thought that that situation was working and saw this area as a kind of narco paradise. Nice neighborhoods in Culiacan, and we've been told that many of the residents here are involved in the drug business. Well, there are lots of new big houses going up in this neighborhood. Huge mansions.
Local economists estimate that narco trafficking is the single biggest industry in Sinaloa, making up 20% of the economy.
All around me, you can this big building boom that's been going on in this city over the past 10 years. And in many ways, these very legitimate businesses have been benefiting from narco money. You have the traffickers and the dealers making lots of money, and they, you know, had to spend it. And so the drug trafficking business, in a way, created this whole narco society.
One thing that people like to spend their money on is fancy cars.
I hear that Hummers are very popular in Culiacan.
Exactamente, sí. Nosotros ahorita como esta unidad lo estamos vendiendo, pues muy bien.
There's a myth that some of the narcos like to drive, you know, big fancy cars. Do you get, you know, a lot of narcos in here buying these cars?
No necesariamente, porque ya ve que aquí hay muchos agricultores. Somos líderes en producción de maíz, tomate, camarón.
The tomatoes are great, the shrimp is great, the corn is great. I just haven't tried the marijuana yet.
También es muy buena, es de acá, que es el principal productor.
Well, we're the main producer, so it's supposed to be good.
It's supposed to be good. Muchas gracias.
Ándale para servirle.
could say that this right here is where it all started. In January 2008, one of the Beltran brothers, El Mochomo, was arrested right in front of his house right here. And the Beltran brothers believe that El Chapo set him up. It sparked a split in the Sinaloa organization, and it sparked a huge wave of violence. Oh, wait, there. Not stay here too long.
No, let's stay.
Okay, so right here you can see that someone has left him a message. It says, "I love you, Mochomo. I miss you. You're a little girl."
The drug war is being fought out on the streets of Culiacan, but the actual cartels come from a remote region of Sinaloa known as the Golden Triangle, where few dare to go.
We're about an hour out of the city now, and the area has become a lot more isolated. It's just pretty much wilderness around us. And we also haven't been passing very many cars. We've passed about 5 cars in the last 5 or 10 miles.
Another 45 minutes or so, and we arrived in the main town just outside the Golden Triangle.
So we just arrived here in Badira Guato, and the region around this town is where virtually all of Mexico's most powerful drug lords come from, including El Chapo.
As we were getting our bearings, an army patrol rolled in.
It seems like such a small, quaint town, and then you see scenes like this, and it just reminds you about the violence that goes on in this region.
We hooked up with Omar, an official in the mayor's office, who agreed to give us a tour of the region.
Hi, I'm Lauda. Nice to meet you. These are our police escorts. We are headed out of this main city into one of the smaller towns. Our escort is telling us that the soldiers have been destroying a lot of the marijuana fields in this region, and it's left people struggling to find any source of income. So they've been turning to banditry, which is why we have our police escort to make sure that we can get to the next town safely without getting robbed.
But even though the army has recently begun eradicating the marijuana around the village we were in, the authorities hesitate to go farther into the Golden Triangle.
We're told that the town where El Chapo and where the Beltran Leyva brothers are from are 5-6 hours deep into the mountains. And I asked our escort whether or not there's a police presence in those towns, and he said, no way. He said, those guys and their families, that's the law.